get started. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you this morning just for the opportunity and privilege to come and study the Word of God. We thank you for the Spirit of God being here to give us insight and revelation of the Word into our lives. We thank you, Father, that you are good and you're altogether lovely. We thank you, Father God, for your people who have hearts that are open and receptive to the Word of God. And we declare that the Word they receive this morning will bless them and challenge them and help each of us to be better. And so we just thank you, Father. We magnify you and we give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so we have been sharing with you on developing healthy relationships. Developing healthy relationships. In fact, we kind of retired to developing and cultivating healthy relationships. All of us need healthy relationships in our lives. We need to be aligned with people who benefit our lives and who do not take away from our lives. Amen? Amen. Now, last week we talked about developing and cultivating a healthy relationship with God, the Father. And so we kind of share with you that it was important that we have a right relationship with God first. If you would turn with me to Mark chapter 12. Mark chapter 12 and verse 30. Mark 12, verse 30. And we said last week that the only way to initiate this relationship with the Father was through the Son, Jesus Christ. In other words, there is no other way to God but through the Son. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life. He said, no man comes unto the Father but by or through me. In other words, you can't get to God unless you go through Jesus Christ,
Amen.
The Son.
Amen.
Why? Because all men are flawed. All men are imperfect. And so in order for us to stand before a perfect God, we needed to be perfect. Well, we couldn't do it within ourselves. But God did send his Son, a mediator, praise that name, Jesus, who lived a flawless and perfect life. And the Bible said that when we receive Jesus Christ, we enter in through him. So that when we stand in the presence of God today, we stand there as though we have never committed any sin, because we stand there under the covering of Jesus Christ. Praise God. That's why the Bible says that you and I are seated in heavenly places. Why? Because we are seated where Christ is. He is the head and we are the body. And we enter in simply because of what he has done for us. He has purchased our righteousness for us. The Bible says he who knew no sin became sin. So that you and I could become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So you're no longer a sinner saved by grace. You were a sinner, but now you are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. That's good news. You don't want to go around when people talk about, well, you know, we just all sin. No, hold up. You don't know who you're serving. Amen. That's not me anymore. That's who I used to be. Amen. Because the Bible says, 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's what? A new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. And all things in this new creation are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. You can't be new if you're still old. Isn't that true?
Amen.
So then why would a person say, well, I'm just an old sinner, saved by grace? Hold up. You don't understand your relationship. See, that will contaminate your relationship with God. Because then you'll start feeling when you miss it, you'll feel like you're not worthy to approach it. Well, you know, I messed up. You know, I'm just an old sinner. God, hold up. Now, wait a minute. God says, now when I look at you through my Son. The flawless perfection of Jesus has been applied to your life. He made an exchange with you.
Amen.
On the cross, he became everything you were, so that you could become everything he is.
Yes.
And the Bible says, even as Christ is right now, so are we in the world, in the earth. In the world. So however Jesus looks right now, guess what? You look just like him. Now you may think, but man, I'm so flawed and imperfect. You're looking at you through you, but you got to see you through him.
Amen.
So when God looks at me, he sees me as flawless.
Amen.
Does that mean we don't repent for things we do wrong? No. But well, we do repent for the things we do wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But that has nothing to do with the relationship.
Mm-hmm.
That has to do with fellowship.
Amen.
And those are two different things. In other words, my son is my son simply because of the blood. We have a relationship. I'm his father, he's my son, because the blood can't lie. And if you look at me, Bull looks just like me. You can't deny. I mean, in fact, he looked at some of my little school pictures. He said, is that me? No, boy, that's me. You just look like me. In other words, he can't deny me because of the blood.
All right.
So that's the relationship of father and son that we have. However, if he is rebellious, we may not be able to have fellowship.
Well,
come on, amen. He want to come in the house. Tell me he going to come in at 2 in the morning. And no, that ain't going to happen. Amen. You gotta have to move, son. You have to go somewhere else, because we don't live like that up in here.
Mm-hmm.
So fellowship will be broken, but the relationship will forever be there.
Amen.
He is my son, I'm his father, I can never deny that. But the way he conducts himself is going to determine whether or not I have a fellowship with him. And it's true with us. We have relationship with God through Jesus Christ if we've received Jesus. But we may not be in fellowship with God because of how we live our lives. We may live in rebellion to what the Father has told us to do. Mm-hmm. Thus, that will not cultivate a healthy relationship with Dad.
All right.
Amen? And so we talked about that last week. So this week, we're going to talk about how to develop a healthy relationship with self. Mm-hmm. Amen? Now, if you should be at Mark 12, verse 30, it says, and this is what Jesus said about the greatest commandments. He said, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. Now, notice he uses the word all, meaning there's nothing left over for you to give anybody if you gave your all to him. So then the only thing I should be able to present to anybody is the love of God. I take that into my relationship, my relationship with my friends, my relationship with my wife. Everything has to come out of the love of God. Because if I gave my all to God, that means the only thing I have is whatever he pours into me, and it flows through me into the lives of other people. Now, so last week we shared with you the importance of a right relationship with the Father. We stated that the only way to initiate this relationship was through the Son, Jesus Christ. Once the relationship is initiated, it then must be cultivated. So then you have to cultivate a healthy relationship with you.
Amen.
So the second healthy relationship we must have is with ourselves. Listen, but without a right relationship with the Father, the relationship we have with self will be perverted and twisted. It is only through our relationship with God the Father that we can have a proper perspective of loving self. The agape love of God allows me to maintain a right relationship with me. Because you can get all out of balance without his agape love helping me to stay in balance. So look at Mark chapter 12, verse 31. He gives us the second command. And the second is like, namely this. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And so I was reading that, and the Spirit of God kind of stopped me, and he said, "No, take note of what I said, as thyself." He said, the reason why people have dysfunctional relationships in their life is because they are dysfunctional within themselves.
Yes, yes.
He said, you can't love somebody except the way you love you. So if you speak down of you, guess what you're going to do to other people? You're going to speak down of them. So I learned a lot of that. This is why you know people hurt. Because when people are hurting and they hurt people, that is an indication that they themselves are hurting. When a person is truly agape loving themselves, then they can agape love you. That makes sense?
Yes.
So he says, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So then what then becomes the example of how to love myself? It comes through my relationship with God. Because the Bible says we love him because he what? First loved us. But most people don't even understand how God loves them. They still think God will burn down your house. They still think God go get you because people tell their kid, you better be good or God go get you. God go get, he go get you. Well, who want a God that your whole premise of knowing him or getting him involved in your life is when you do something wrong. And then he show up to break your leg and to burn down your house and to kick you around and I told you, I go get you. Who wants a God like that? But that is the concept that many people have about the love of God. Listen, because that is the concept that they themselves have about love.
Mm-hmm.
They think love will get you. Love will get you. Love will get you. But what about, how about love will bless me?
Amen.
How about love will be patient and kind with me?
Mm-hmm.
How about love being gracious to me?
Amen.
Why is it always going to get me? Why is it always going to beat me up? Why is it always going to burn down my house? Why is always he going to take stuff from me? Because he's trying to get me. That's an unhealthy relationship. And it is an unhealthy mindset towards God. And if you have an unhealthy mindset towards God, where true love comes, then how can you have a right perception of love when you don't have a right relationship with him? Because he's the only one that can show you what it's like. You know, there have been times when I've missed it and I was taught, God go get you, God go get you, God go get you. And I remember I missed it, and for about 2 weeks, I didn't talk to God because I thought he would go get me. And so, but I start missing him. You ever miss God, just I'm missing his presence? I said, well, you know what? If he go yell at me, fine, but I miss him. So I'm going to go, and no kidding, in my mind, I went into his presence like this. And I was waiting for him to yell at me. I was waiting for him to be upset at me. And he just, you know, all he said was, he said, Don, I love you. That's all he said was, Don, I love you. He didn't beat me up. He didn't kick me. He didn't come and break my leg. He didn't burn down my house. He loved me. He just said, I love you. And many times when we think that God's going to get us, he really just said, I just want to love you. Because what? Because you remember that song we just sing? It says, love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else would help, love lifted me. And you know, that, you love that song, don't you? Because it shows you that love is something that builds you up and not tears you down. But yet we've told people of a God who would tear you down rather than build you up. So then if we don't have a right relationship with God, how do I have a right relationship with self?
Say that.
It's impossible. That's why you have such dysfunction in the world. That's why people have dysfunction in their relationships, because they have dysfunction within themselves. They have a perverted and twisted view of God. Thus, they have a perverted and twisted view of themselves. Why? Because God created us. So that if I want to know me, I got to get to know him who can tell me about me.
That's right.
Amen. All right. So he says here, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. So here's the question you have to ask yourself. How should we see ourselves based on the word of God? Because if I don't see how I really am before him, I don't know how to love you. If I see myself as no good, worthless, well, how can I treat you any other way other than the way I see me? Because he just said, love your neighbors as you love yourself. Now, think about how many people abuse themselves.
Amen.
They verbally abuse themselves. They mentally abuse themselves. They physically abuse themselves. Mm-hmm. But then you want the people who abuse themselves to show love. Now I see why Jesus, the first commandment is, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Why? So by giving him your all, he can fill you with himself.
Amen.
So that when you try to love people, you don't love them out of self, you love them with him.
Say that.
So then my relationship with people is directly affected with my relationship with him.
Amen.
In fact, my relationship with myself is directly affected with my relationship with him.
Mm-hmm.
Because you know that we are real hard on ourselves when we miss it, aren't we?
Amen.
Why? Why are we real hard on ourselves? Why can't we can't? You remember when you was a kid, you was out playing or something, you was running, you fell, but the game was so exciting, you jump back up, and you dust your knees off, and you got back in the game again because you didn't want to miss nothing. Why? Because you had something you loved. But why is it as believers when we fall, we want to lay there and go, oh, woe is me.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, woe is me. Why do we do that? Because we don't have him to love. And then we base love, listen, we base love on performance. Listen, as a parent, here's what I realized about myself. As a parent, if I feel like I didn't measure up to something, when my son did something that was less than, maybe let's say he got a C, all right? Because I don't measure up on the inside of myself, I now force that same mindset onto him. That ain't good enough. Why you ain't? See, you need to stop this. You need to stop that. You need to spend more time reading. You know, I remember watching an episode of Andy Griffith. I love me some Andy Griffith. Mm-hmm. But Opie got a report from his teacher that he wasn't doing good in math. You know, so Andy said, "Well, I told that boy I wanted him to do better." So he started making Opie study all the time. In fact, he made that boy study, can go out and play. You got to study. No, go hit those books. Go study. And the next report came out, and Opie was doing worse. What? I made him study more. And then what did the teacher say? "Hold up. You're being too hard on him. He's got to go have fun. He's got to go play. He's got to be able to release all that." Come on, amen. But see, those type of actions will create the wrong mindset in our children. Because we have them. Now think about it. All right. So how should we see ourselves based on God's word? Because how we see ourselves is how we treat ourselves. And how we treat ourselves is based on our own thoughts, words, and actions. This is a clear indication that a person has self-esteem issues is that they seek to manipulate people to love them through gift buying, giving themselves physically, even when it is a clear violation of the word of God, and accepting abusive treatment verbally or physically, and perceiving that as true love. Mm-hmm. That happens to people.
Amen.
It's a perverted, twisted view of love. Mm-hmm. Now, I've been there.
Come on.
Tell the truth, shame, devil. Mm-hmm. You know that too. And we convince ourselves that something that is a perversion is okay. Mm-hmm. And then we pass it on to our children because we let them see it, and that becomes their norm too. Mm-hmm. And this is, we should not think lowly of ourselves, but neither should we think too highly of ourselves. Mm-hmm. We must find the balance, mm-hmm, which is only truly found when the agape love of God is applied to our lives and we walk in it. In other words, it's the agape love of God that helps me stay in balance and not think lowly of myself, but also not to think too highly of myself. Because there are some people who think way too highly of themselves. I mean, I watched a show one time where the parents gave the little 16-year-old a brand new $50,000 car. And she comes out and sees it. They got a big bow on it, you know, 16. You get a brand new car, $50,000 with a big red bow on top. She comes out and starts doing, I'm thinking she likes it. It's the wrong color. It's the wrong color. What? I want to get a running star, boy. I said, what? The wrong what? Oh, he ain't getting nothing. I take that car right back. And they try, honey, we're so sorry. We'll get you to.
Sick. That's right.
I gotta get my grip and start kicking real good. I mean, what's wrong with you? Why would parents do that? They have a warped perception of love. God, you know, in God's love for you, he'll tell you no. He'll say, no, I love you, no. We don't want to tell people no. When you feel uncomfortable telling somebody no, something's wrong with you. When you know you need to tell them no, anybody been there? Mm-hmm. You ever do something for people and you know you shouldn't do it, but you do it anyway because you're feeling kind of guilty about it? Mm-hmm. And then after you did it, you felt guilty about giving them something you know you couldn't give them anyway because you couldn't afford it? Really, anyhow?
Yeah.
Why didn't we say no? Because we didn't have a perception of love. We adopted our own perception. And so now we're trying to buy something that really we don't have to purchase because God freely loved us. And the Bible says perfect love casts out fear because fear has torment. You know, so every time we do actions like that, I'm including myself, when we do things like that for people when we know we shouldn't do it, it's birthed out of fear. Fear of rejection. Amen. Fear of perception. Mm-hmm. We're afraid what they're going to think. So what you're doing is you're reinforcing a wrong, or you're cultivating through those actions a wrong relationship with yourself. Thus, when you do that, you're going to have unrealistic expectations of other people. So when you want something and they say no, you're going to go back to, well, I always do it, even when I don't want to do it, why shouldn't they do it for me? Mm-hmm. Come on, man. Ain't that good?
Yeah. Amen.
So your our actions are cultivating the wrong relationship with ourselves. Look at Psalms 139, verse 13. And we're going to answer this question, how should we see ourselves based on the Word of God? And we're going to read verses 13 through 17. Psalms 139.
Goody.
And I'm going to read this from the God's Word translation, just because I kind of like the way it read. Psalms 139.
Okay.
Psalms 139, verse 13. I'm sorry, I messed that one up. Psalms 139, verse 13. And I'm reading this from the God's Word translation. You get there, say amen for me.
Amen. Amen.
All right. And here's what it says. It says, you alone created my inner being. You knitted me together inside my mother. I will give thanks to you because I have been so amazingly and miraculously made. Your works are miraculous. And my soul is fully aware of this. My bones were not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, when I was being skillfully woven in an underground workshop. Your eyes saw me when I was only a fetus. Every day of my life was recorded in your book before one of them had taken place. Mm. How precious are your thoughts concerning me, O God. Mm. How vast in number are they. If I try to count them, there would be more of them than there are grains of sand.
Mm.
When I wake up, I am still with you. Amen?
Amen.
Now, I'm going to give you four things you need to know about yourself. Four things. Number one, you need to know. You're taking notes, write this down. Number one, you need to know, say this. I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Hey, say it again.
I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Now listen to this. When I understand the value the Father places on me, I will never sell myself for less than the value the Father places on me. Remember this. You are a masterpiece.
Amen.
I don't care how you feel, care where you've been, care what you've been through. You are God's masterpiece.
Glory.
You say, well, people have abused me. People have mistreated me. People have left scars upon me, physical and emotional scars. And you are still God's masterpiece.
Amen.
No matter what people say.
Amen.
Amen.
That's where it starts. You got to know you are fearfully and wonderfully made. Mm. So that you don't feel like, oh, somebody likes me. Don't even matter if you like me. Why? Because I know that I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
Doesn't matter your age, you are fearfully and wonderfully made.
Amen.
Number two, the second thing you need to know about yourself. I am never alone.
I am never alone.
Come on, amen. Say it with me. I am.
Never alone.
Never alone.
And listen to this. This frees me from the need to have somebody in my life who could possibly lead me down a wrong path.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, amen. When I'm never alone, you know, when you're never alone, man, you don't have to worry about who comes and who goes. Because you're not alone. God, the Lord says, I will never leave you. And I will never forsake you. Lo, I am with you always, even until the end of this age.
Amen.
Am I saying it's wrong to desire to have a relationship and marriage? No, none of that's wrong. But you don't look for that to complete you.
Yes. Amen.
You look for that to fulfill His plan for your life.
Amen.
Come on, amen.
Amen.
You know, you don't get married because y'all love me, Usually, here's what I found out. People who talk like that, they usually stay alone for a long time or they go get themselves a mess. Because what God wants to do is He wants to come to the place where in your life that He is more than enough. When He can entrust that you are more than enough with Him, then He'll send you somebody, because then He knows you're not going to get them out of balance in your life, and they'll never replace your relationship with Him.
Amen.
Because many people come to church and say, I'm looking for a good man. I'm looking for a good woman. They get a good man, good woman, and they gone. And don't come back to church again. I hear many men say, I didn't want a good, godly woman. I didn't want a good, godly woman. They get a good, godly woman. Guess what? They send her to church, and then they stay home. Because I want somebody to cook. They're going to know how to submit. You're not even submitted to God, bro.
Come on.
You're supposed to be leading your family to the house. Now they're begging you to go. That's out of order. But his wife, you know, if she had had a right relationship with God, God would say, oh, don't you marry that rascal. Don't you do it. Don't you do it. He would have told her not to do it. But people do it anyhow. Number three, you need to realize, I am never alone. Number three, I have someone who thinks well of me even when others don't. You need to know about it. I have someone who thinks, you ain't gonna do no better than me. Oh, I got someone who thinks well of me even if you don't. Come on, amen. You gotta know that. Notice this. This type of love and acceptance always leads me back to my Heavenly Father. It always drives me back to His presence for acceptance, for validation. Come on, say this. Say, God thinks,
God thinks
well of me.
You need
to know that. You say, I just blew it. It don't matter. God still thinks well of you. Why? Because what did the psalmist say? That he had written down every day of my life before I ever lived one. He thinks well of me. And number four. Listen, I have someone who knows me intimately and does not walk away even when I seem unlovely. Mm-hmm. Think about that. I have someone who knows me intimately and does not walk away even when I seem unlovely. Listen, that becomes the model for the relationship you want to have in your life, even in marriage. If you know you got somebody that loves you even when you're unlovely, I'm not saying they tolerate it. They just, you know, you do whatever. You know, because, you know, when people act unlovely, I still correct you, but I don't walk away from you just because you act unlovely. Because why? Now, why is that? Because I see your value. Oh, come on, praise the Lord.
That's right.
You want somebody to see your value. Because when you lose your mind sometimes, and we all lose our mind sometimes, don't we act up? When we talk crazy sometimes, we just, we do life just hits us sometimes. But you need somebody who sees such value in you, they're willing to work with you to bring you back to center.
Amen.
But see, here's the thing. If you don't have that relationship with God whereby you can understand that and see that, you might just pick any old body just to have somebody.
Amen.
And you don't want that. Amen. This is, when we don't know our own value in Christ, we are willing to allow others to abuse and mistreat us. We settle for so much less because we feel so unworthy. But the flip side of that, you can feel so bad about yourself, you can't accept something good in your life. I mean, have you seen people that who always sabotage their life? Every time something good happens, they sabotage it. You know why they convince themselves, it can't be real, this can't be real. Well, when they find out about it, they're going to leave me anyhow, so I might as well go ahead and mess it up and be in control of it before, you know, they find out. What is that? Their image. They have a really unhealthy relationship with themselves. All right. Now, listen to this. There is healthy validation that a father can give his children or a husband to his wife or a wife to a husband that doesn't lead to an addictive behavior. We all need a sense of validation. You know, God made us that way. Well, we need somebody to come along and say, I believe in you. We need that. Amen. But not to the point where it becomes so addictive that you don't do anything unless you get that. No, that validation is designed to strengthen you so you can walk more and more on your own every day so that you're not dependent upon someone always telling you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. Because you need it. You've got to be able to be complimented by someone saying, I love you, and you can say, thank you, and then you can reiterate that to them, reciprocate that to them, but you're not receiving it with some sense of worthlessness, and they're trying to convince you that you're lovely. You don't want that. That's too much work. Come on, amen. I mean, how would you feel if someone said, I love you, and they go, no. I really care about you. No. Tell me again. And I really do. Oh, no. What's happening? They got a poor self-relationship. Now, what's going to happen? They're not going to have a good relationship with me. Because then I become their source for feeling good. No. People, listen. You can be confirmation, but you can't ever be my source. You can tell me you love me, But the source, my Father, already told me He loved you. You just validate what He already told you. Yeah, praise the Lord. And I'm able to receive it. I'm able to receive that into my life and not feel like I got to do something to earn it. Amen. That's too much work. That's too much pressure. Because you always got to be perfect. When you're waiting on, when you're trying to get other people to validate your love, that they love you. It's too much work, isn't it? Because you always try to do everything perfect. Because if you do something wrong, they just might stop loving you. Then that means they're not loving you like the Father loves you.
Amen.
Which means you have a dysfunction in yourself, which is causing you to have a dysfunction with them. All right. Pray that help you. Now, I'm going to give you four practical ways to cultivate a healthy relationship with yourself. Four practical ways, real simple ways. Number one, and the most important one, spend time with the Father daily. Why? Because you become like the company you keep. And He helps you keep balance in your life.
Amen.
Spend time with the Father daily. Just make time. And I'm not talking about you got to spend an hour, but spend some time just saying, Lord, just tell me you love Him.
Thank you.
Just talk to him. Make some time. 5 minutes a day. Sit aside 5 minutes. A lot of them want to tell you I love you. I'm not asking for nothing. I'm not looking for nothing. I just want to just tell you how appreciative I am for you being my Father. Have a time to set aside where you don't go asking for stuff all the time. Because that's what most times when people talk about, that's all they ask for. Ask, give me. You don't like people like that in your life?
Come on.
Come on, isn't that true? Every time they show, they say, give me, thank you, bye. And sometimes they say, give me, and they take it, they're gone, they only say thank you. No, you have a time to spend time with your Father that's loving. Just like I always tell couples that when they have date night, when you got date night, when you go out on your date with your wife, your husband, the husband and wife going on a date, don't talk about the kids. Reaffirm the relationship that you have with one another. Amen. Build that thing. Say, girl, I remember when I first saw you, you were slamming. And I want you to know you still slamming. Come on, amen. Now, here's what women think. Stuff has dropped over the years. But here's what you don't understand. What makes you slammy is your love for Jesus.
Yes.
The Bible says, a woman that fears the Lord is great to be praised. Man, that's hot to me. That makes a woman look fine to me. A woman that loves God? I don't mean the F-I-N-E, I mean the P-H-Y-N-E one, fine, when she loves God. It's a turn on to every God. Don't you think that turns the Father on? When you loving on Him, He makes Him want to bless you. He'll just say, oh, just empty his pockets for you, thank you, oh, woo. And that's what the word says. A woman that fears the Lord is greatly to be praised. We don't care if stuff drop. Just don't drop Jesus.
Amen.
I'm telling you, man. Just don't. Whoo. Goosebumps thinking about it. So spend time with Him daily. Number two, the second practical way to cultivate a healthy relationship with yourself. Eat properly. Proper nutrition causes your physical body to function better.
All right.
I mean, I'm going to tell my little story yesterday. I was at the gas station, and I saw some crispy chicken. My wife was like, honey, you don't need that crispy chicken. You don't need the crispy chicken. I said, what about the Mike and Ike? You don't need no Mike and Ike either. You don't need that. I said, so I'm standing there looking at it, the crispy chicken. While I'm ordering my salad, but I'm looking at my, she said, turn around, honey, don't stop looking at you. But you know, the truth of the matter is, after I got the salad and I ate, I actually felt better. I didn't feel weighed down. You know, I didn't feel like, you know, like, oh, I'm going to go to sleep. You know, eat that money, they go, oh. It's a horrible feeling. But it was good going down. But the results aren't that good. But you got to eat right, because you'll feel better. Then she got me drinking hot water and lemon, you know. Then I said, I drank it at the mission. No, you put it, eat it, drink it before the meal to curb your appetite and help the food. Got to help drying up. But you know, I notice how better I feel when I eat better. Amen.
Amen.
And the opposite. All of us have a better relationship with ourselves when we feel good. Isn't that the truth? When you don't feel good, you don't like you, you wish you could step outside yourself for a while. Mm-hmm. So eat properly. Now listen, I'm not, and don't go to an extreme. Because some people get nutty, don't they?
Yeah.
Don't eat that chicken, it's going to kill you. Don't eat it. It's going to kill you. No, I said, you're going to overstep, okay? Everything in moderation.
Wow. All right.
That's why you need a relationship with the Father. Why? Because he'll help you stay in balance.
Yeah, right.
Sometimes you'll say, baby, go get the chicken. You know, you get your chicken. Just one piece, though. Get your chicken. So there's a balance in that. Amen? You got to have a balance. Don't get all nutty with it. You know, don't force it on everybody else. Hey, you eating cottage cheese, now everybody in the house got to eat cottage cheese. That might be your conviction. That ain't everybody's conviction. Amen. Come on, amen. Because you're getting out of balance again. Let the Lord, that's why you need to spend time with the Lord daily so he can help you keep this in balance. But try to eat properly. Amen.
Amen.
Number three, nurture the healthy relationships you do have. If you have good, healthy, godly people, you're like, nurture those relationships.
Say that.
Amen. Spend time. Send them a nice little message. Hey, they didn't want to know I was thinking about you. Mm-hmm. Love you much. You don't even have to go out and hang out. But just nurturing that relationships, it also builds you up when you think outside yourself and you start helping other people and encouraging other people and letting other people know that they mean something to you. Amen. That's some people who so Jesus, that they don't appreciate nobody. And it's all about getting this Jesus thing. I've seen many people build ministry on the broken backs of its members. And I'm not going to do that. I'm like, no, we will take our time. We got to go slog out. So I don't care. We got to go to a snail pace. As long as we're making progress, we're running our race. And that's all that matters. And the people aren't broken. I mean, what good would, if I put 100 people in a race, and we're all in this race together, and I'm all on cross of the finish line because I ran everybody else in the ground. And I'm like, yes! Woo! Yeah! Woo-hoo! And I look back at all my folks back there dead. Passed outside. Now, would that be really victorious? No. I want everybody to finish the race. Right. Come on, amen.
Amen.
But that's a selfish attitude that you have with yourself. All right. The question is this question. Why do so many... number four. Here we go. Number four. Number four. This is the fourth one. Be active. Not busy, but active. Live an active lifestyle. And what I mean by active, I don't mean you going here and there everywhere, but don't just sit around and just lay on the couch and become a couch potato. Now here's a question. Why do so many people pass away rather quickly after they retire?
Yeah.
They work for 40 years and grew up. Man, 2 years into retirement, they're dead. Why? Because you were built to have purpose. And just because you may retire from the workforce, that doesn't mean God ain't got a purpose for you. And you need to find out what it is so that after you retire, you got something to do so you don't go. Listen, so your body, your mind just don't wither away and die.
Amen.
People die very quickly after they retire if they don't have a God purpose. And that leads me to my fifth thing. I didn't have a fifth thing. It's on here somewhere. Y'all need a recap. Wait a minute. I know I put it in here. I had it in here. Oh, no.
Four.
I said four, didn't I?
Yes, you did.
Yeah, I did say four. But I had another point to make. I don't know what it is. I'm just looking for it. I wonder what happened to it. Oh, it is on here. That's five. Yeah, sure it is. Yeah. Okay, five practical reasons. Five practical ways to cultivate a healthy relationship. I knew I had another one. I wrote it at the last minute because God gave it to me. Number five, and this is the last one, the fifth practical way. Live with God's purpose leading you. Live with God's purpose leading you. This is what Jesus said. Jesus said that his meat was to do the will of his Father and to finish his Father's work. And the word meat means substance. That word substance deals with the source of living. So he said that my source for living, or my reason for living, is to do the will of my Father and to finish his work.
Amen.
You need purpose beyond retirement. You know, what we think about retirement in the Bible, they were just getting started. I mean, seriously, Moses started at what, 70? Abraham was 73 or 70. I mean, they were in their 70s before they got started in the will of God.
Amen.
So they ain't over here. We throwing you. I'm thinking about retiring. To do what? You better have a God purpose. Because fishing will get old, hanging out, going on vacation will get old, you know, traveling will get old. You need a purpose. You were created for purpose.
Amen.
Every day of your life was handwritten by God himself. There is something else he got for you. Just because you leave the corporate world don't mean you leave his world. He might got something else for you to do. Amen? So here's my closing comment. Going about life telling others you know you're valuable is short-lived. You do not actually walk in that value. This value we have of ourselves is seen in the decisions we make, the company we keep, and how we overall live our life day to day. Allow others the freedom to come to their own conclusion as to whether they feel you're a good man or woman. If they don't see it, it may be a clear indication that they are not the person the Father has for you, and you keep it moving. Amen. You keep it moving. Amen. Don't worry about what other people think about you. You know, you ought to thank God for the people who don't like you. Because they might have been the wrong one. You ought to thank God for the people that insult you. Oh, you ain't fine enough. You ain't pretty enough. You ain't handsome enough. Thank God for those people. Because they wasn't the one for you. Because the one God has for you will see your value beyond you.
Amen.
Amen. All right, so that's all I'm going to give you today. And we'll stop right there. And I pray that blesses you. And so, again, we're dealing with developing healthy relationships. Amen? And, again, have a good, healthy relationship with you. The Father first, then you. Because you can't love others until you first love yourself.
Amen.
And you can't love yourself until you first love him.
Amen?
Amen? Praise God. Well, let's pray. Hallelujah. Father God, we thank you for the word today. We thank you for your people. And we just pray, Father, that each of us would just be ministered to by your Spirit. That we may even look at areas of our life where we may not have truly loved ourselves the way you intended. Father, I pray that there's areas of our lives that need correction. We just pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will give us that correction. And that we purpose in our heart to make the adjustment so that we can truly love people with the agape love of God. And we give you praise, Father. We give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.